Dobrý den. To je jediné slovo, které řeknu česky dneska. Good afternoon. Now we will speak only English. I hope you are enough prepared to listen. And I would like to welcome Mr. Peter Morgan, who after you leave this room will turn you to great scriptwriters. Let's start right from the beginning. You studied first art in Austria. What was the point when you decided to write? And was it in the beginning literature, or it was always more drama?
You want to hit the microphone? Oh, really? Okay. Well, I didn't want to, you know, life is full of surprises. And I really didn't want to be a writer at all. I was reading the other, maybe some people, oh God, it's terrible. It's a really sensitive one.
It depends on the...
Hello? I think if I don't move, it will be okay. Wow, this one's really sensitive. I definitely didn't want to be a writer. I was a reluctant writer. In fact, I didn't want to write ever, and now I'm happy that I'm a writer. And I'm now doing a job where, for the first time, I'm at least as much doing other things as writing. So, casting, you know, really producing, working in the cutting room, working, and I miss the writing so much. The writing, so I've sort of, my journey has been one of falling in love with writing. I was not in love with writing when I started. I think probably I liked telling stories like this, you know, blah, blah. But writing was such a, that's just a terrible punishment. And, but I, the first thing I did was, when I went to university, and I, in school, it had been the same. I loved being around the theater and acting, and I think you either belong. I think you either think that for me, the connection is all with theater. I would still say, for a writer, the best training is either to direct and then find your way into writing, or to be a to do the theater. And for me, it was theater. I wanted to be an actor because, you know, it seems like a fun thing to be. And I was a terrible actor. And very quickly, I realized I had no talent. And that meant, you know, I couldn't understand how was I going to stay involved in the theater, which was what I loved. And so then I thought, well, the next step, if you can't act, maybe I'll try directing. So then I was going to direct something, but I wanted to take it to the Edinburgh Festival, the Fringe Festival. And I didn't know how to afford, you know, there was a certain amount of money. I went to the university. I was very entrepreneurial. I went to the university. I said, I need some money. We need an apartment. We need to rent a theater. We need a van. We need lights. We need this, blah, blah, blah. And I organized all this money, but I didn't have the slightest idea what the play was. And then they said, right. And then I looked at the money and I sort of said, well, we've spent all the money already and we haven't even bought the rights to the play. So then I thought, well, I better write it. only as a cost-saving exercise. I mean, this is how you think when you're 18 or 19. And I didn't think that maybe it would be a good idea to start with the play. Anyway, I wrote a play with somebody, and for some reason it worked. It was a fluke. It worked. I wrote it especially for young people. And since that day, I've never done anything else. Since that day, I've never had a job other than writing. I've never done anything else. I've written today. How many people have written today? Come on. Yeah. So you guys are writers. The people who did not put their hands up are not writers. I honestly think that. I sort of think, you know, that's what you... I wrote on the plane coming here. Yeah. I did, I'm afraid. If you were to kill me tomorrow, I've had this conversation with my therapist, of course. I said to the therapist, if tomorrow at 6 o'clock in the evening was the execution of you, would you still see any patients in the morning? He said, yes. And I'm the same. If I knew I was going to die tomorrow at 6 o'clock, I would still write for 3 hours in the morning. I don't know what else to do. I mean, I there are other things to do, but they're not as interesting. And I'm not good at many other things. And I you know, somebody asked in the previous session, when we were in the press conference thing, you know, what advice would you give writers? And it's just to write. The rest is out of your control. Everything else is out of your control. But you can control whether you go to your desk and actually write. The rest is just good luck. And sometimes you have good luck and sometimes you have bad luck. I've had lots of both.
I have to apologize. I should also introduce Pavel Jech, for the dean of FAMU, who helped us at Midpoint, who helped us a lot. He's here with us. So thank you very much. Otherwise, thanks a lot. What was the, when did you switch to the script writing? What was the point? What was the first script you wrote?
Well, this play that then went to Edinburgh, a man came backstage, a producer came backstage, and he was making training films. Does this exist here in the Czech Republic? Training films. So he made, for John Cleese, do you know who he is? He's an English actor who was in Fawlty Towers. It's probably...
John Cleese.
Yeah, from Monty Python. Yeah, yeah.
Yes, of course.
So John Cleese had this very successful video company where they would make training films for people in industry and banking and this shit. This man came up afterwards and he said, I make these training films for John Cleese's company and another company. Would you like to try writing one? And I was still at university. And I said, sure. And it would be like examples where a customer goes to a bank and is rude. How do you handle the customer, you know? These were the little scenarios that I was writing. And it was amazing. And I really remember this. It made such a deep impression on me. One of these things was set in a petrol station, you know, a car repair place. And I remember writing in the stage directions, you know, the scene where I think it was the manager of this company would then take responsibility for her, I don't know, some shit. But I remember describing the workstation, the place where they were fixing the cars. I remember saying the floor is tattooed with oil and grease and petrol stains. And then I turned up on the day when they were filming this, and there's the first moment where you see a truck has turned up because of something you wrote. You're like, a truck, lights, you know. And it was so exciting. This excitement has never diminished. this excitement. I still love it when I turn up, I go, look, a crane. I turned out and I went into the, and there were people making, like Jackson Pollock, they were making like the floor, tattooing the floor. This floor was never going to be in shot, ever. And they were doing this, and I remember thinking, wow, look, they're tattooing the floor. This was like one of the great, it was like losing your virginity. It was, it was one of the great moments of my life. So I started doing these training films, and then I never switched to screenwriting. I think I'm quite unusual in this regard, I still write theater, television, film, all the time. I'm passionate about all of them.
Went through any kind of education, how to write, and what do you think about these genial books who teach you how to write? There are several like iconic books about scriptwriting. Is it helpful to go through it?
Well, I was lucky because I had a friend, and so I was co-writing, and this really helped. Because I don't think I would ever have done it if I was on my own. And then there came a point with this chap, he's called Mark, and we were, best friends, super, super best friends. And then there just came a point where when you have an idea, and it's an idea that you really passionately care about, and it's somehow connected to your own family or your own personal experience, you can't share writing it with someone. You can co-write ideas, but you can co-write scripts, but you can't co-have an idea. Mm-hmm. An idea, if it comes from somewhere deep inside you, and so it's so unique to you, it's like your fingerprint or something. And so there did come a time when Mark and I went our separate ways, only because I suddenly thought, this is one I really need to do on my own. Also, he wanted to write, he really enjoyed leaving home and going to work. We did the rewrites on a very, very, you will never know it. Not, thank God you're all too young. There was a terrible film called King Ralph, where John Goodman became the King of England. It was just a terrible film. And, oh, that's my phone, sorry. Sorry. And it meant that we had to go every day to the film set because we were doing the rewrites, the production rewrites on this film. And he loved being picked up by a car, going to the studio, and being part of a team. And I really hated it. I really liked being at home, and that one of the great joys of being a writer is being private. And so we sort of also reached not just a, Mark and I just, we reached a dividing point, not just because of co-having ideas, that being a problem, but also actually what he wanted as a way of life, as a writer. Because there are so many different ways of being a writer. And you have to find your way. And with regard to books and courses and everything, I think, again, I remember in the beginning, do you know about Robert McKee? Do you know who I mean? No. So Robert McKee is the sort of the most famous American script doctor, lecturer, guru, who looks very like, I think you are old enough to remember who Alexander Haig is. Do you remember? He was the American Secretary of State. Anyway, he was. He looks exactly like Alexander Haig. And he started, and he's the first person who referred to screenplays as having three-act structures and all this sort of stuff. And he, when he first came to London, his course lasts 3 days. And I couldn't afford to go to it. And so Mark, me, and one other guy, we put the money together, and then we each went for 1 day. And then we told each other, like, oh, and he said this, and he said this, and you've got to do this, you've got to do this. So then we started writing scripts which were exactly like this, which were really terrible because they had, you know, they were just, oh, but on page 27, it has to become another act. And then, fuck, my act happens on page 33. It's a disaster. Change the typeface. Now it's on 27. But it's... I don't know if it helps or it doesn't help. I think actually these courses maybe help producers more than writers, so that producers, when they're talking to you, feel they understand stories, because, you know, writers understand stories intuitively, of course they do, and but producers can often feel it's a foreign language, and if you are given a language in which to deconstruct this stuff, maybe it helps them. I don't know.
This is a great advice, because I mean we are here for in this country, the market is much smaller, but I have this feeling that producer can't read scripts. Mostly they don't understand what they read. They can't distinguish between a bad script and good script. And it's a good advice, so we will spread books about writing to producers.
So, yeah. Except then they'll say, why doesn't it change on page 27? And you'll be like, oh, no.
How you are looking after ideas, but mostly ideas of your movies are where around? Is it, and what? When is the moment when you know this historical idea, this moment, this could be a whole script, a whole story? And or the character, and what's more, character or the story?
Well, I mean, the truth is you just don't know. It's like falling in love, you know, you don't know. Someone can describe to you the perfect woman or man, and you think, ooh, this looks good. And then you meet them, and then it's like nothing, you know. And you don't know why. You don't. It's that crazy. It's the same thing. I mean, I think I was working as a writer for a long time before I found... First of all, I just want to give... when I think of... I'll share any bit of advice that I was given that made me feel good. Because I think the ones that make you feel bad, you shouldn't pass on. The one that I felt good was... Stephen Frears told me. He's become a very close friend. The best creative years in your life are in between 40 and 60. And I am absolutely 100% in agreement with this. I did not find my voice until I was 40. Mm. And so if you haven't found your voice and you are 26 or 27 or 23 or 24, it doesn't matter. And if you've had rejections, it doesn't matter. My writing trajectory was like, I was like, I'm going this way, this way, this way, this way. And then I did one job that just went boom, like this. Mm-hmm. And since then, my life has been going like this. Mm-hmm. It was as simple and dramatic as this. Mm-hmm. And for me, if this was a movie, there was actually a moment which I can remember where I was in an airport and I saw a book which was written, I don't know if, do any of you remember who Tony Blair was? No, you've got to ask now. Most people have no idea who Princess Diana was. You know, you're old, very old, yes. Yeah? But you know, you have to actually not be arrogant enough to assume that people know anymore. And so Tony Blair, he had, you know, when he was leader of the Labour Party, even before he became Prime Minister, there was his biggest friend, his closest friend, was also his political mentor. And it was this chap called Gordon Brown, who then subsequently also became one of our Prime Ministers. But Gordon Brown was the one who it should have been. It should never have been Tony Blair. It should have been Gordon Brown. And I didn't know this. Like everybody else in the country, I just assumed there was Tony Blair and this other guy, Gordon Brown. And Tony Blair was slightly better looking and he was more accessible. The other guy was a bit like this. And So it's natural that he became the leader of the Labour Party and then Prime Minister, right? He was more connectable. But this unbelievably interesting Cain-Abel story was underneath their, you know, the reality of their relationship. And I was in an airport and I saw this book and it had a picture of Tony Blair and Gordon Brown, and it was called The Rivals or something like this, the book. But the light on the cover of the book, they were shot like people from a film noir. And it wasn't satirical, it was serious. The book was saying there was a serious emotional history behind these two people, which was interesting enough to make this person write a book about them. And I looked at that and I had never seen anybody photograph a politician like this before. You know, in the way that you would photograph actors, you know, it looked like a shot had been taken from a theatrical rehearsal in the theatre, you know, in black and white, with them looking at one another in a kind of, in a look that was riddled with history and pain and murderous intention. It was Greek. And I found myself taking this book and reading it, and that was the moment that I saw the Lord. but this book made me realize, think of public figures in a slightly different way. And the person who wrote the book and I became good friends, and he became an advisor, and I wrote a film about Tony Blair and Gordon Brown. And that was the moment where, and I had been working as a writer for a long time prior to this.
I'm curious when you say that it's necessary to write every day what you do, but your films are based on so much research material. So even when you work on a film and you don't know where it will follow or a script, you still do your 3 hours of writing and then you 7 hours on in the material research.
No. That could easily be plotting. Yeah, no, or reading or researching. Yes. That's part of writing, of course it is. Yeah. I don't mean doing your pages.
Yes.
The pages comes right at the end.
So how you do this research? Do you have also some team of people who
I do
help
now.
You?
Yeah. Now I have a team. No, I do. I have a team because I'm working on a show. And, you know, I do now have a team of researchers. It sounds ridiculous, but I do. I didn't before. I used to do it all myself. But, you know, it's not unusual. You know, most people have a team of writers. I actually just have it. I'm doing the writing, and I have a team of researchers.
You know, it comes later when you turn 60.
What,
you will have only the team of writers.
I don't think I will. I don't think I will, because I think that it depends what you do. You know, I'm now very involved in this business of what it is to be a showrunner, which is a whole new, I mean, it's not a new phenomenon because television has existed all this time, but a lot of writers are now having to have these completely different roles because, you know, Netflix and a lot of these shows, a lot of these series are exploring, it's a really wonderful, 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 wonderful time to be a writer. I mean, it's a boom industry if you're a writer. If you're a cinema owner, not so good. But if you're a writer, it's a good time. It's a really good time. And that doesn't matter how you do it, whether you do it as a team, whether you do it as an individual. You've picked a good, if any of you are interested in writing, you know, I'm assuming that's why you're here. You know, I'm here to say it's good. It's a good time. It's a very good time to be a writer. I would much sooner be a writer than a director now. They are making a really bad decision going down the director course. It's very hard, very, very hard. And all the pendulum is really swinging towards the writer.
When I see so many young writers, I'm asking myself if the market is enough big. And on the other hand, I have to say that there is really so many writers are required even here on this market that there is still not enough. I mean, if they're good writers.
Yeah, no, sure.
Still not enough.
Sure, I agree with you. And the need, you know, the demand for content has never been greater. You know, in England, the biggest challenge at the moment in England is not to get something made, it is to find the people who will make it. That is to say, the sound stages to film in, the editors to cut it, the camera crews to film it, the locations, you know, that's the real problem at the moment. The problem we've got in London is, as soon as you have a bunch of scripts and you think we want to shoot these, you sort of go, right, where are we going to shoot them? And you ring up, you say, we've got the go-ahead, we've got the green light, and they say, well, there are no film stages available in London for 3 years at the moment. Warner Brothers bought and built an entire studio complex in England just so that their films would have a place to film. They don't rent it out to anybody. It's just so that they don't get faced with the problem. It's a huge complex, just so that they don't get that problem of there's nowhere to film. So, you know, I've read in the newspaper recently that somebody in America was saying too much television is being produced. There are not enough people for the television shows that are being made. But and maybe that's true. But it, for a writer, it's quite a good problem to have. And there really is now an opportunity, if you have a talent, you know, for a writer to control much more of the journey of their material than ever before.
Did it happen to you when you dig deeper into the historical material that the truth you discovered influenced your ground idea and your story had to go a bit different direction?
Oh yeah, all the time. Oh yeah. And often, you know, you think it's one thing and then you look into it, you research it, and actually your heart breaks because it becomes something else. I'll give you a good example. Somebody came to me and said, do you know, I think the Amy Winehouse, do you know Amy Winehouse? Yes, you know what I mean? Yeah. So somebody came to me and said, Amy Winehouse's father is interested in you telling his story. And I thought, wow, that's just a fantastic, you know, I'm a father, I've got a teenage daughter. What a fantastic story. I had this idea who he was, and that he had this daughter with this extraordinary talent, but also with this self-destructive part of her. And how, as a father, what do you do? How far do you push? How far do you pull? How far do you intervene? How far do you sort of say, actually, the important thing is her music, or is the important thing her health, or whatever? And so I thought, I suddenly thought, this is the perfect way to tell Amy Winehouse's story. This was before the documentary was commissioned. I thought, what a perfect way to tell Amy's story, which is not through Amy, is to make her the small character, to make the father the main character. I got very excited. I was absolutely sure this was a brilliant idea. And then I researched it. And I just thought, this is not a man I want to write about. That, you know, the more I found out about Amy Winehouse's father, the less I liked him. And even though it's interesting to write complex characters, my heart broke with every page of his autobiography that, you know, I was just like, oh no, you're this guy. Why can't you be this guy? Why can't I write him like this guy? Well, the truth is because he's this guy. And it was very painful because there was a wonderful, you know, now Asif made a wonderful documentary, but there was a sensational story to be told about a father with this terrible dilemma. And this happens to me on a daily basis where the reality breaks your heart. You know, and you sort of either have to drop something or change course or,
When I watch almost any of your movies, I always ask myself, what is the portion of fiction and what is true and where and how far you can go, how you play with it, especially if it's like Queen and Prime Minister, but also other stories that are always very concrete, historical figures, more or less. So...
Well, I mean, there are so many different answers to that. But mainly, you have to use your conscience. I have to look myself in the mirror. You know, it's ultimately my relationship is not with the critics; it's with myself. And I know when I'm. So the truth of the matter is, I will tell you the truth if you ask me any question. Was that real? Was that not real? I'll tell you the truth. And if it isn't based on fact, then I will give you an explanation for it. What was the name of the gentleman that I just did the interview with? Do you know what his name is? The
Marek Eben.
Yeah?
Marek Eben.
Yeah, he just asked me in Rush, did James Hunt punch the journalist? And I said, no, he didn't. But he punched just about everybody else. If you have a look on YouTube and go James Hunt punch, he hits everybody in the world. He's just walked on, bang, he hits other drivers, mechanics, his manager. And so James Hunt was somebody who hit people.
Yeah.
And the journalist that asked the question in this press conference asked exactly the question. This was a quote, a verbatim 100% quote. It's available on film, you can check that too. James wasn't at the press conference. But at this time, James's relationship with Nicky changed. After the accident, James was more compassionate towards Nicky. So I wrote that, and I'm okay. I sleep at night about this because I think it was a responsible fabrication. Yeah, and I've gone on Nixon did not ring Frost in the middle of the night, but Nixon was ringing just about everybody else in the middle of the night. He was on a mixture of Dilantin and mood stabilizers and alcohol, and in the latter stages of his presidency, he was in blackout, drunk dialing from the White House. So, with no recollection, but about 15 people listening in going, what? And that's how we know he was drunk dialing. And so I felt it was okay for him to drunk dial David Frost. When the Queen sits with the Prime Minister, I don't know what they say, but then the good news is nobody knows what they say. And but I think if I was writing something that was so far off the mark, people would complain, they would walk out, they would tell me that, you know, I do my best, you know. You don't know, but that's a difference between accuracy and truth. I try always to be truthful, but sometimes I'm not accurate.
I think this is already Aristoteles wrote that it is not necessary to be real, but to be believable.
Yeah.
Sometimes something which happened in reality is not enough believable.
I think that's true. I think it's also, again, I comfort myself because when I did the research for Frost Nixon, and I did this research myself, I met all the participants and I talked to them all. And here were, yes, a lot of time had passed since 1977, so almost, 40 years had passed from when I was writing it. But these were still, apart from Richard Nixon, everybody involved in the Frost Nixon interviews was still alive. And I tracked them all down. And their versions of what happened in these interviews were so dramatically different. And they were all in the room together. And that really made me... that was the first really graphic example I got of how vulnerable historical truth is. And historians get terribly excited about historical truth and accuracy, but most history is just one person's fiction. And that doesn't mean I have a license to go away and create a bunch of horseshit. I do think an audience is very, very sensitive, and an audience will reject something if they feel it's an irresponsible fabrication. They will reject it.
You said that you like more or less to write alone, not in a team. But script is something which is good to rewrite. It's better to change something in script than in editing room. Definitely cheaper. Do you have also the feeling that sometimes you need a good script editor to read, but it doesn't need to be the professional script
sure.
editor? So whom you like as a partner for this reading to get the feedback? And what is for you good script editing?
Well, actually, I find... Is that me? Is it the wind? Is that better? I don't know. Is it? Okay. So I find, and this goes back to the theatre days, I find... is it annoying? Tell me if it, just somebody put your hand up if it's boring or annoying, and I'll just talk. Hello. Okay, so I find that is it gone? Oh, okay. So I find, going back to the theatre roots, the best thing is not somebody else's script notes. Jan Fleischer will kill me for saying this, but, I found... Yes, I often ring my team. I will send a script through, and I'll say, tell me what you think. And they'll say, but actually I find that my personal... the best way forward is to have a reading, and if possible to get really terrible actors. So we would have my team of researchers who are brilliant researchers but catastrophic actors. And so in the show that I was just have been writing, I would even get people to be not who that, so I would get a man to be the queen, I would get this, so that the voices were all wrong. And then I would get them to read it. And if bad actors reading a script, if the script is still interesting, then you've got a chance. And so that's how I do it. Because actually, when you then all get around... So I would do a draft of a script, and then we would sit around a table and read it terribly. And it's pretty clear what's wrong. It's pretty brutal, and I tend not when I've heard it, I tend not to want anybody else's notes. I hear it and then I pretty much leave the room, and I'd say, don't anybody call me for 3 days. And for 3 days I'm like, you know, because I've made notes all over it. But I find that the most brutal way to expose your script is to read it out loud, out loud. Don't keep it as a script on the page. Do with it what it's supposed to do. Have it performed. That to me is the most valuable way forward.
This still doesn't solve the problem of structure.
Yes, it does.
Even
oh yeah, it's either good or bad. And if it's bad, then you've 100% started the story in the wrong place. That if it isn't good, the problem's in the first 5 pages. Don't look anywhere else. Yeah, it starts wrong. It doesn't start great and then go wrong. It always starts wrong. Where to start a story and where to end a story is just like, if you've got that, you're away. I mean, in fact, you can't really go wrong. Once you have a good start and a good end, I mean, of course, yes, but the big existential problems are over. The rest is just work. You know, some people love structure and some people just love writing. And I particularly like structure. I love breaking a story. I love thinking, ooh, no, that was wrong. And also then what happens is, in the perform, you know, a show, I mean, for example, this is, I'm assuming this might interest you because it's the same crazy job as I do, right, that all of you are doing. But I found, so I've just made this show, and it's a Netflix show, and I've just written 10 hours. And today is the last day of filming the reshoots. I must come back to reshoots. Remind me to come back to reshoots. The most important thing in the world. But whatever you do, I'll say it now, whatever you do, put 15 or 20% of your budget to one side to reshoot it. Mm. Whatever you do, put. You don't know what your film is. Amazing things happen to a film that have nothing to do with you, that are out of your control. That something happens to a film. You write a film, it's perfect. You shoot it exactly as it is. You cut it together exactly as it's written. You look at it, it's a different film. What happened? And you have to accept that it's rather like, you know, when you build a bridge, you have to allow for the fact that in the heat and the swing, it becomes a different bridge. The mathematics change. And in the process of making a film, everything changes. And you have to allow for this. Woody Allen allows himself the luxury of reshooting the whole thing. I don't think you necessarily need to go that far. But I have found that at least 10%, and if you don't need it, then amazing. But I've never, ever encountered that. I've never encountered. So, for example, on The Queen, it was so interesting. We felt it was good when we'd made it, but it wasn't good enough. And the American producer said, "We want a scene of." Actually, I don't know why I'm making that stupid voice. He's a really good producer. This chap called Scott Rudin. He's a really highly intelligent man. I'm like, wah, 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 and he's not like that at all. But he was suggesting that actually the film would profit from having a scene where the Queen sort of loses her temper, and you know doesn't quite throw plates. But he said, I want an Oscar scene from Helen Mirren. And, you know, there's something not firing about her performance. And it was true. So we rang Helen and we said, look, we want to book you for a couple of days extra shooting. And then I tried to write scenes where she was losing her temper with Tony Blair. Prime Minister, let me tell you this. Ah, let me tell you. I was like, she doesn't talk like this. This is ridiculous. This woman doesn't have any feelings at all. Why would she have... Why would she start behaving like Eva Perón for no reason at all? And I don't understand. But we had the money to reshoot it because we promised them we would do the scene where she would throw plates and, you know, behave like a diva and win an Oscar for throwing plates. And we then, Stephen Frears and I, took the money and reshot only Tony Blair. Only Tony Blair. We reshot 5 scenes and added more Tony Blair. When the Americans were asking us, you know, how's the shoot with Helen going? We said, it's going brilliantly. It's going absolutely brilliantly. Helen was on holiday somewhere. We weren't shooting her at all. We were reshooting Tony Blair. We were adding minutes and minutes and minutes of Tony Blair. And the effect of it was, it transformed her. By putting more of him in, it made her part... Is the fire? It made her part bigger. That's where I fell in love with reshoots and rewriting and reshoots, was because the film just went like from here to here, just simply based on putting in more Tony Blair, when actually all we wanted was more Helen. And Helen won the Oscar and she never filmed another minute. Michael Sheen didn't win the Oscar and he filmed an extra 20 minutes or something. But it was a cruel thing that we film more of one and it ends up being more about... But that's what I mean about you lose control. You have no control. You have to accept. The film then has its own life and its own spirit and its own soul. And you have to respond to that. You can't just leave it. So we now have made it a contractual part of shooting this show. After the first season, we did so many reshoots that I've now made it, I'm going into the second season, we're going to keep aside 15% of the budget, 15, 18% of the budget, so that we definitely reshoot. Anyway, today is our last reshoot day.
Yeah.
So we've been filming for 8 months. And, you know, it's all different now. It's so different now. Everything, the landscape has changed so quickly, you know.
The actors are always contracted for their reshoot.
Yeah, but for something like this, the most important thing now, from a production point of view, is to get actors who are cooperative. You know, we don't need stars. For this Netflix show, we don't need a star. They've given us the money. It's amazing. Here is the money. I get no notes, not one phone call. They gave us $120 million to make 20 episodes. And they, you know, I feel so responsible because they have put all the power in the hands of a writer. It's just amazing. There are no producers that are in charge. There are no directors that are in charge. There are no film stars that are in charge. The entire huge project is in the hands of a writer. And it's great, no? And I feel so responsible because I don't want to fuck it up so that they say we can't trust writers. And so far, it's a very, very happy production. But we have to just see how people respond, and you never know how people will respond. Yes. But that's what I'm trying to say is there are only three kinds of film being made now. I was thinking about it before coming today. There are blockbusters, you know, tentpole movies, which is what the corporations that own film studios want to make. So you have films like Batman versus Superman, which leave everybody connected with them depressed. I was with Hans Zimmer, the composer, who was so depressed. He just finished the music for Batman versus Superman, and it looked like he had an illness, you know. He was like, I just finished. He said, I'm never doing superhero ever again. And then there are sort of award season films, what are called sort of fourth quarter films, like Spotlight, the one about the financial system, which I've forgotten. The Big Short. And these are films which are made specifically to try and capitalize on the Oscar season and the economics that are involved with the Oscar season. Mm. Unfortunately, all of these films underperformed. The Danish Girl, blah, 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 blah. All these films were a financial disaster, actually, because the cost of promoting them was so high. And then there are local, regional films, you know, for the home market, like the films you make here for the Czech Republic, German language films, and so forth. These are the only kind of films being made. You know, television is television, by contrast, at this particular moment in its cycle, is absolutely where intelligent adult drama is going, where actors want to go, where writers want to go. There's a huge momentum shift. And with television and this long-form narrative come unbelievable possibilities for the writer, not just as an artist, but as a producer and as a businessman, because they need the story more than anything. And I think, by the way, in cinema, the director is overvalued and the writer is undervalued. And I think in television, the writer is overvalued and the director is undervalued. I do think it's sort of crazy. Why do we say that television is a writer's medium and film is a director's medium? Well, they're exactly the same thing. At least they're becoming exactly the same thing. I think that the show that we've been making feels to me like cinema in 10 episodes.
Mostly your stories are concrete historical stories. Do you think that always a certain distance is needed to write it? So you would not write a drama about something which happened yesterday,
No,
right?
I think that's a brilliant question. I think it's a brilliant question. I get this all the time. You know, will you write about... I think Daniel suffered from it when he made the film about Julian Assange. Mm-hmm. I think it was way too soon. I don't think we know who Julian Assange is yet. How can we make a film about a guy we don't even know who he is? And also, if you respond too quickly, it's journalism. If you, my rule is a decade. It needs 10 years. For me, it doesn't mean I'm right, but for me, for my taste, if you wait 10 years, then you have an opportunity for something to have metaphorical value, as well as, you know, it can be about something other than itself. If it's so, if you're responding to something immediately, A, film is the worst way to do that. Why would you resume something where the turnaround time is? If you're going to respond immediately, then do it on high def and get it out on the internet now. Don't make a movie. Or wait 10 years and let it be about something other than itself. You know, today's hot topic story might feel dull as ditch water in 18 months, but it might become incredibly interesting again in 15 years. You know, so in answer to your question, I always wait. I always think, God, it needs 10 years. I've been sent so many ideas by producers, which I feel it's a good idea, but it's way too soon. You know, I don't know. I don't even know what it is now.
So, what moment from the past 5 years is the moment you are waiting for another 5 years? Of course, you won't tell me.
Well, no, because I don't know. I think you've got to wait 10 years before you know if it's interesting or not. You know. I mean, of course, right now, today, seen from the perspective of today, a biopic about Donald Trump would seem like an obvious place to go. But if you did that, it would be probably rather like the one they made about George W. Bush, which had no secondary depth. And that's because it had no perspective and you couldn't reevaluate it. And if I'd have made a film about Richard Nixon, I would never have thought about making it about Richard Nixon and David Frost. It was David Frost that made that film interesting. It wasn't a film about Richard Nixon that was interesting. It was about the combination of this idiot and this idiot. You know, that together they make something special and they become about something more than that. And, you know... It needs time to come at it from a strange perspective, I think.
You mostly deal with this historical material, archives, all kind of thing. Do you sometimes also observe life and you would write a dialogue you listen to in a pub or something?
Well, I mean, of course, but you know... Wow. Okay. I think it's about, you know, it's about hearing voices. And, you know, if you go to a writing class, they will tell you how different is the dialogue between all these characters. So if your dialogue for this character is the same as your dialogue for this character, have you found two people who miraculously speak in exactly the same way? Or... are you a bad writer, you know, or have you not been listening? And I think that actually listening to how people talk is incredibly valuable. And being able, there are some voices that I just simply can't write, you know, and other voices that I can write naturally. And, you know, one thing I've found actually is more and more and more, it's hard for me to write an idea that someone brings to me. It has to somehow find... Last King of Scotland someone brought to me, and I felt I could write Idi Amin, which is a terrible thing to say, but I, you know, I wrote him really easily, and you know, and it flew out, whereas sometimes, you know, I can't really... I couldn't write a young American person. I just couldn't. I wouldn't know what to do. I would feel insecure. because I don't have the voice in my own head. Certain voices I have in my head and I can write them. And there's no worse feeling. We all know it. I should say, I think at least 50% of my time spent as a writer has been on projects that have not been made. I have a little file on my computer in a folder called Fail. Only a writer would do this, right? And in which I have listed all the projects which have never got made. And every now and then I look at them and I wonder what would happen if every single one of these, we discussed it earlier, if every single one of these had been made and every single one that I made hadn't been made, I don't think I'd be any more or less successful. I think there are three or four of those that I think, wow, they're really pretty interesting, but they didn't get made for certain reasons, or there are times that I just couldn't write it, or I failed. But a lot of my time has been spent on something that never happened, and I think that just is part of the job. That isn't time that's wasted. That is again, just because you didn't end up with that person doesn't mean that all the other loves in your life were wasted. For some reason or some reason not, things do or don't, and you can't control it. And as a writer, you can't, it's just part of it. Not making the job is part of the job. The other thing that's part of the job is realizing that every job is different. So your role, I'll give you an example. The last commission job that I got was, I wrote a script for Ang Lee. Ang Lee rang me up and I flew to Cannes and I met him. And I knew I was going to say yes to anything he said. I was going to write this. So I thought, well, okay, whatever this man says, I'm going to write this. I may write it badly, but I'm going to write it. I'm just going to say yes, because it's Ang Lee. And he told me what it was about, and I said yes. But in this job, he's the boss. It was his idea. It was because of him that I got paid by Warner Brothers at a certain level. It was, other times a producer will come to you with a book and the producer is inexperienced and you are more experienced than them. But it's still not you in control because it's based on someone else's rights or the book rights. So in every single job, your role and your position in the power structure of that job is different. And you have to be flexible. The best piece of advice I got from someone in this regard was to say, every job is a party. And every party has a host. And you are either inviting people to that party or you are invited to that party. And if you're invited to a party, there are certain rules. You don't get to choose what the food is. You don't get to choose when the lights go out. You don't get to choose when you go home. You accept that you're a guest. And being a writer involves so many different parts of negotiating complex situations in collaborations. My personal choice, but I don't think this is an easy piece of advice to receive when you're just starting out, is hold on to it as much as possible. If the dream job, come up with the idea yourself, write it yourself, don't take any money. Hold off, never take the money until the last possible moment. The later you defer taking the money, the more power and control you will have. And if you can afford to not take the money, don't take it. Every time you take money, you lose power. And worse, in Hollywood, when you take a lot of money, they hate you. So they go, I've never known anything like it. They go from adoring you to hating you in the space of one phone call when you agree to do the job. The minute you say yes, they're like, you shit. Up until before that moment, like, oh my God, we love you. We love you, 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 we love you. Will you do it? We need you, we need you, we need you, we need you, we need you. Yes, I'll do it. It's like, what did I do? I just said yes. It's unbelievable. And then they abuse you, torment you, punish you, you know. It hold on to your idea as long as possible. If whenever possible, come up with the idea yourself. Be as entrepreneurial as you can. Feel like a producer. There's a natural correlation, I think, a natural affinity between writers and producers and directors and actors. Writers are producerial, I think. And I would encourage writers to be as producerial as they can be. Producers probably won't like that, but it's okay. They need you. And hold on to the idea. That's the biggest piece of advice I would give, is hold on to the idea as long as you can and take the, I'm sorry, but don't take the money as long as you can. Because the money will only get bigger the longer you hold on to it. The more elements you can bring together and the more real the project becomes, the better.
Here in this country, I have a feeling that you should take the money and run.
Why?
Because you never know what happens next.
Really? Is it the Wild West?
Yes.
Here? Yeah. Well, that's tough. And also, you know, because of the because of how dominant the English language is, of course, you know, come and hang out in England and America for a bit, if you can. If you can write in English, of course that transforms your prospects. Because actually, people in England and America are desperate for outside perspectives. They're really valued. You're not prejudiced against. You know, if you can write in the language, you know, above all, if you can think in story terms, if you have original ideas, ideas is really the currency. You know, ideas is power.
Do you think that those scripts which ended up in your shelves can be once repolished, or you should forget and not dream about it? Like taking out and you try again?
I've not had success with digging out old ones. Some people, I guess they do. I must say I've not had success with this. I think that there is a moment where an idea is current, and I think you have an idea at a certain moment in time for a reason. I think when the idea comes to you, it comes to you at a time both in your own personal life, but also politically and anthropologically and socially, because what's happening is what's happening. And when time passes, of course there are some ideas that are a good idea. And you see this a lot, really a lot, in particularly in Hollywood. When you go from being an actor or a writer or a director that has no power or currency in the market to suddenly having a huge hit and then suddenly everybody wanting you, particularly directors, who then have the power to green light something. They can say, well, I've always really wanted to make this project. And everyone's heart sinks slightly because they know it's the one that's been in the drawer and it is, you know, it's done the rounds. And often there's real merit in the idea, but it's an idea that is somehow out of time. And for some reason, an idea that, you know, if you have a look at storytelling styles, they change so quickly. You know, genres that were completely current and fact. The romantic comedy genre is like the kiss of death now. If you go in, and for 10 or 15 years, that was the number one preeminent genre to pitch. Now it's biographical fiction. Unfortunately, I know, it's a disaster. I hate it. There's so much of it. Everybody's walking around, this is a true story, it's a true story, it's a true story. Make a fucking story up. Jesus Christ, what's the matter with you? And, you know, Everyone's flicking through their encyclopedias. Oh, here's a true story. Here's another true story. You know, it's sort of, right now I wish there was more fiction being made, but there are complicated reasons for why this doesn't happen. Mainly branding and marketing.
I think producers and also commissioning editors are kind of cowards who just want to repeat again and again some formulas. For example, here in all televisions, you can write only crime stories now. That's it.
Yeah. Yeah. It's the same in Germany. If if you go to German-speaking countries, at any time of the day, you can put on the television and there will be a detective figuring out who's killed who in Darmstadt. And there will be, in 1 hour of television, there will be 58 minutes music on a synthesizer. You're like, did somebody's finger get stuck on this thing? It's the most depressing thing. So you think, I can't watch this. You put on another channel, there's another one. He's a fat one, a fat detective, a thin detective, an old one, a young one. Oh, how many people are dead in Germany?
Yeah, there's much more dead in television than in real life.
Yeah, no one's alive in Germany.
Maybe this is a question I should start with. How is the method you go? Like, there is the research and some concrete story, then you do an outline, and you go also the other steps, like short synopsis, long synopsis, treatment, or when you already have a good looking outline, you switch to script.
Yeah.
Because also you don't need probably to convince the financiers, people with some synopsis, and so you avoid this part.
No. I do it every time. Yes? I do it every time. Not to convince people, but because I need
it's you.
To be my satellite navigation, but I'm aware of the fact that, everybody has their different. I was once on. It was actually in the year of the Queen, in America. You have to go and publicize these movies. You know, the punishment for making a good movie is the Oscar campaign. You know, it's like they just all the pleasure you get from having made a good movie is destroyed, as you have to go and publicize it for months and months. But one of the interesting things was where I met some other writers, and they did this I forget where it is. It's just north of Los Angeles. It doesn't matter. No. They did this panel where all the writers of the movies that year were on the panel, and they asked exactly this question, how many of you storyline? And the answers were so exotic and different that you would never think we were all describing the same job, The guy who wrote Little Miss Sunshine, who then went on to do Toy Story 3, which is a very good script, very good script. He's a chap called Michael Arndt, and he was very... almost like Asperger's, and autistic. He's like, well, I write a scene, and then I send it to three of my friends randomly, and I tell them to mark it out of 0 to 10. And if it scores less than an 8, I throw it out. And then Jason Reitman was like, well, I pretty much put it all on one piece of paper and sketch it, and if it works, and then I said, well, funnily enough, I always do outlines, and somewhere in between 14 and 17 pages of outline is where I know, when I get to that level, I know it's time to start writing. I said every time it starts with a little bit, but I go on and then I get to 15 pages of outline, I know it's time to start writing the screenplay. This is just me. And then there was Guillermo Arriaga, who wrote Babel, and he was like, what is outline? This is a ridiculous concept. He said, I write from my stomach. I do not know where I am going. If you know where you're going, you write banal. You know, and we were all like, yeah, you're probably right. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But then you watch Babel and you understand. Yes. You know, it's like, whoa, this way, maybe this way. And but it, you know, everybody has their own way. So I'm somewhere in between Babel and Little Miss Sunshine.
Yes. When you mentioned this guy of Little Miss Sunshine, that is like the little independent film Little Miss Sunshine and big Hollywood blockbuster, are you expecting also to get a call for a real Hollywood big blockbuster?
Oh, how do you mean? Me?
Yes.
How would you react?
It depends.
No, I've been asked to write a lot of films that you've now seen, but I didn't, you know, they're just not really what I can do. No. If I politely get a telephone call, I can't think. I've been asked to write some really silly, I mean, crazy things. Yeah. And I was briefly involved with the Bond film. The one where Judi Dench dying was my idea. Mm-hmm. That was what I contributed. You've got to kill M. But then they didn't like my idea for how to kill her. So I decided not to do it because I felt that they, you know, it's very, most of the time I was asked to write Star Wars. So I was flown in a private jet to Skywalker Ranch, which is in Northern California, near Palo Alto actually. And I don't know if you know the history behind how Skywalker Ranch was built, but it was built because George Lucas hated Hollywood. So he built this entire world as a fuck you. And you walk around it and it just feels like fuck you. Everybody's unhappy. It makes no sense. You walk around and it's like tumbleweed blowing around and you're like, this is the weirdest place in the world, in the most perfect place in the world. It's the most beautiful place you've ever seen in your life, and it's miserable. It is dripping in misanthropy and hatred. And so then it was like, George is ready to see you now. And so I went in to see George. And I didn't understand a word he said. He was talking about it, and I said, look, I really think it's probably better for you and for me. You know, I don't want to destroy what's obviously been a very successful. I said, there are some really interesting Greek archetypes with fathers and sons and lost sense of family. And you know, but I said, ultimately, I think you need somebody who's a real geek, you know, and I don't know why I'm here, but I'm afraid I was too immature to refuse politely from a distance. I did want to come and see you. And he was like, well, that's very honest of you, Peter. Fucking waste my time. I then got on a plane and flew back. No, they didn't put me on a plane. I went back on a normal jet. I went back on an airline called JetBlue, but I flew up on a private jet. That tells you about that. Yeah, I still haven't seen Star Wars, but I gather it's rather good.
Neither me. Maybe it's time for your questions, because we have a couple of minutes more. So, if you have any. Yeah, here, one. No, there is, okay, there is a microphone, so first the microphone goes here. Okay, microphone comes then. So please, stay there, otherwise it will take too much time. Yeah. It doesn't work anyway, so.
Whatever it is, the sense of the language itself, and I
No, but I totally agree with you. If you can, it's of course it's better. Of course. But I figured that at some point, for you as an individual, you might want to try engaging in other cultures, you know, because it's not an uninteresting thing to do. But I completely agree with you, and every attempt I made to go to America and write for the American system was less successful than when I stayed at home and wrote for the British system about subjects that I know and understand. So I completely agree with you. But I am aware of the fact that there are just more opportunities, and you might enjoy it. You know, having a bit of both, trying a bit of both. But everything, I think all success is innocent. And you're more likely to be innocent if you stay at home. Every single success I've had has been where I have not thought that it might be successful. I've just done it for the right reasons, and then it became bigger. And so your idea of it being microscopic but becoming global, I completely agree with this. Nevertheless, most film production of one form or another, whether you're producing or directing or writing, is done in English, and I just thought you might want to experience some of that.
So thank you for your answers. Everything was very interesting, but I would like to repeat the question that you have been asked, but you haven't
I didn't answer?
Answered it.
Shit.
Completely. So it is about studying. So can a person be taught how to write? And is it worth to spend thousands of euros on studying, writing, doing a bachelor's degree, master's degree? Is it worth or not?
Well, I mean, the simple answer to that is, you know, if you're a degree qualified screenwriter, it won't necessarily make you a better one. But anything, I slightly worry that in the process of analysis, you know what I was talking about how if reading, having something read out, was the best way of getting feedback and learning. So I guess my answer to that is that it's not just about reading, it's about hearing and what you hear, and if you can hear the story clearly when it's being performed, even when it's being performed badly. And I worry sometimes that in writers' groups, whether it's literature, novels, or screenplays, that writers are highly intelligent, often passive-aggressive people, and they can destroy one another. And I mean that with, and Jan will hopefully forgive me for saying this, but, you know, tutors this too. I think a tutor can destroy you. A tutor can build you up and create you, but they can also destroy you. And so I would just be very careful who you let criticize your work. You know, ultimately, the best doctor of the patient that is your project is you. And you have to trust yourself in that process. If you are constantly asking other people to be your satellite navigation system for the story, you can't write it well, because you're constantly writing with other people's thoughts in mind or other directions in mind. And ultimately, it's fine to hear their opinion, but you have to know your own. And so if a writing process keeps you focused on the business of going to your desk every day and writing, great. But if you are hearing other people's voices that you're trying to write for, to gain approval for, or acceptance of, by, that's a catastrophe. And you have to only hear your voice. I'm sure that's not an easy thing to happen overnight, but at the same time, I think writing courses can destroy as many writers as make them. And you just have to be really careful who you let operate on your patient.
Would you recommend any writing course that you hundreds of thousands of writing courses, and it's difficult to understand, or how to understand which is the best one or which is the.
I think, look, you know, if you know, you get your my career is full of moments of luck and coincidence and bad luck, and I can't work out where the path came from. I do know, actually, Jan was absolutely, was present at the time when my life went this way. Remember, we talked about this book. Jan was working with me on that one with Stephen Frears at the time, and ever since then, you know, I found my voice, you know, around this time, and that happened quite late. I was 40, and you know, 38, 39, you know, something like this. And my answer to you is, I can't tell you. There is no path. All I would say is, if you possibly can, don't do any other job. So don't go and work in an office and try and write, only because it just minimizes the amount of time that you write. And if you do write, just write anything. Just write anything. It doesn't matter what, whether it's a short play, a short film, a radio play. It doesn't matter. But just write and keep writing. And eventually, you have to be. It'll happen very quickly for some people, and it'll take a long time for other people. You have to find your voice. This is what you're looking for. You're looking for your voice, the thing that you can do that no one else can do. That's all anybody wants. All anybody wants is for you, as the writer, to go, I know exactly what I'm doing here. And for you to speak, for you to bring a set of individual and unique things to this that are just you, nothing else, no one else. So in that sense, the idea of going to a school to learn is a complete contradiction, because actually all we're after is something that is you and only you. But if it stops you going to work in an office and stops you being tired and only going to your script in the evening, for me it was university. I was able to write and write and write. And then I never did anything else, even though I was writing stupid training films for people in petrol stations, you know. And then a lot of it is luck. Sometimes good, sometimes bad luck. But all your only path is to find your voice. That's all that matters.
Hello. Yesterday I watched Rush again, and I got from the internet a script for Rush from 2011. So that's like a year or 2 years before it was actually shot. So I don't know how accurate is how much it changed. But I was just surprised. I had my laptop with the movie, and I had the script, and I was just watching it scene by scene. And I was surprised how similar it is. But there were like two changes, and I was wondering if there's a story behind why they happened. So in the script, in the opening scene of the race, there's the car crash. You show the car crash. You don't show it fully, but you kind of allude to it. You show the, you know, Nikki's crash. And in the final movie, you just have a part of that race as an opening with a lot of voiceover, but the crash is saved for later. So I was wondering if it was a decision in the editing room, or
no? I actually can't remember why that happened, except. Maybe we shot it and cut it like that and suddenly thought, well, maybe later it's actually better, don't show the accident twice. I seem to remember we showed the accident in the script. The script showed the accident twice. Yeah. And I think Ron probably felt showing it once was enough. Because in the voiceover, he then said, he implied that something terrible was going to happen and then don't show it. But actually with Rush, the real battle with Rush was the end.
The final race?
Oh my God, this killed us.
Yeah, you had a different like misdirection in the script. You had it. You didn't show how Nikki gave up the race. You know, it was raining again, and you know he was stressed because the trauma and stuff. And he had these flashbacks, and then you left. And then you left this line. And then you went to Hunt, and Hunt thought he finished. He finished like fifth or something or fourth, and they told him, no, Nikki gave up the race. But in the movie, you show actually first Nikki giving up the race, and then you use a different misdirection, as in you show it, like a chaos in the rankings.
Reshoot. That was the reshoot. Everybody.
Oh, that was the reshoot. Yeah. Okay.
Because and by the way, the reshoot was only making it more accurate. It wasn't that in the reshoot we suddenly thought, well, you know, the problem was. In a film in which two people have been rivalrous for the whole time, and they've been, you know, like enemies, the final race has to be the great race, right? And so if you were writing it as a writer, it would be that they're neck and neck. One changes tires, the other one changes tires. They're neck and neck, and they're coming into the end. Who's going to win? Well, in the final race, Nikki pulls out after three laps.
Shit.
That's a catastrophe for a writer. It's like, where's my drama?
The worst race of
Somebody
all.
Somebody stole my drama. There's no drama. And so we had to construct a drama out of no drama. And so, you know, I had tried in the script, in a very dishonest way, to sort of not tell the story. Obviously, you can't tell a story that never happened. Yeah, because it's all there in history. So I tried to, by omitting the story, I thought, okay, I can cheat it. And then we reveal it later. And Ron said, no, let's do it. We've just got to shoot the whole thing as it was. And then you've got to write it so that actually, even though Nikki has pulled out, James finishing fourth is still a problem. So in other words, for James to finish fourth would be the equivalent of finishing first. So we had to construct it like that. And then that end section where they have that conversation in the aircraft hangar and the voiceover over that, I mean, that took weeks of rewriting. I reckon that end scene, which is, I think, my favorite scene in the film, by the way, but I think I did 50, 60 drafts, at least. I mean, just my fingers were bleeding on drafts of this script. Just that ending.
And was it after Ron entered the process, or before that you were having problems with it?
No. I wrote the script and I took it to Ron.
Okay.
Because we'd made Frost Nixon, we became very good friends, and I said, you know, do you like this? And he said, oh, I really like this. Oh, no, originally it was going to be Paul Greengrass. And Ron Howard was going to be doing Captain Phillips, and Paul Greengrass was going to be doing Rush, because Paul's a friend of mine. And then Paul said he wanted $120 million to do Rush. He wanted to reconstruct all the races, because if you're doing Formula One, you can do it for $1 million, or you can do it for sort of $150 million. It just depends on what your attitude is to the racing. The actual character drama between the two men can be done for $1 million. And Ron said, I'll make it for 30. And Paul said, if I can't get 120, I don't want to do it. So Ron then jumped off and came on to do Rush, and Paul jumped on to Captain Phillips. So it was very weird. The script that Ron had developed for Captain Phillips was what Paul shot, and the script that Paul had developed with me, Ron shot.
Just a quick one: the chaos in the rankings was real.
It really
happened.
Yes,
that
yes.
was real. You didn't make that up.
No, of course not.
Okay, thank you.
I mean, do you have any idea how vicious Formula One fans are? If you make one mistake, they're like, you know, they're crazy people. Formula One fans are, you know.
Okay, just very quick question. I'm here. So I'm eager to try your method of reading and kind of trying out with bad actors. I find it very
funny.
There
are plenty of bad actors.
Yeah, exactly. It's going to be so easy. It's great.
Yeah.
And
this is a resource that we never run out of.
But, you know, as I'm thinking about it, how exactly you do it, because there is, of course, a big part of the screenplay is, I don't want to say narrative part, but you explain what happens
stage
when there
directions.
Is... Yes, exactly.
Of course.
Is there a narrator or somebody
yeah.
who reads that part?
Yes.
Yeah.
That's how we do it. So, but often people do two or three different parts.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so you just get a gang of six happy idiots and you get together in a room. And, you know, one person, the important thing is that you don't say a word. The writer does not speak.
Great.
You just sit and listen. And these terrible actors destroy your script. You know, it's a really cold day. The heat is like, yeah. But if it works, it works.
Perfect, thank you.
And by the way, they will tell you, it's amazing how even somebody who's a bad actor will begin to identify with the part, and they will say, my character would never have done this. They start getting very Hollywood.
I was also thinking,
I don't feel this was right for me.
I was also thinking about reading it twice. First with the switched roles, as you said, that man is reading a woman, and then the right way.
Don't overthink it. Just do it. I mean, like, for example, in my research team, the same guy always read Churchill. Now, my guy happens to be very gay and with a beard. Okay, so he was like reading Churchill like this. And it was just so un-Churchillian. But it was just sort of great.
Okay.
And he didn't want anyone else touching Churchill. It was like, Churchill's me. It's just random, actually. Making it random is not overthinking it. And then it's amazing what it throws up.
Perfect, thank you.
Hello, may I?
Sure.
You talk about some kind of breaking point in your 40s when the writing start making sense and the quality goes up. And I would like to ask you if it's connected with some kind of epiphany or something. When did you understand some rules of writing or something like that? Some common knowledge you can share with us?
Yeah, I mean, I really don't know how much is practice and how much is... I don't know how good I am or how much I've just practiced or how much I've just persevered. But I do know I'm better at it than I was, and the reason I think I'm better at it is because what I accept that I can do is become quite narrow. And so there's a heartbreaking process. First of all, in life, when you think, I want to be an airline pilot, a doctor, a politician, a lawyer, a footballer, well, I can't do that. And the things you can't do in life build up and build up and build up until you're left with something quite narrow. And I feel like with what I've ended up doing, I feel like I'm a doctor who specializes in elbows. You know, that really, instead of the whole beautiful body and all the problems it can throw up, I now really only do this. But within this, I'm very confident. And I think that your journey to find the thing that you are good at and then to accept the painful limitations of the narrowness of your focus. And I think maybe that can't come until you're a bit older, until you accept and understand. I didn't think I was going to write or spend so much time writing a woman who I find personally quite uninteresting. You know, I'm not a monarchist. Why would I be writing about the Queen? It's ridiculous. I'm sure, you know, the path to finding what you're good at in life can be quite humbling because it's not what you want for yourself. And where you end up, some people hit lightning immediately, and I'm jealous. And for me, it took a long time writing stuff which was technically proficient, but wasn't unique. And in the end, you're just on a journey to try and find what it is that's unique.
Okay. I have a question on your film Damned United, because it's kind of interesting story. It's known in English society, this story, or how did you find it? Because I find it a very, very special little story about football in 70s. So what is the story behind it? How did you find the theme?
Well, the Damned United came straight after we made The Queen, and it was actually a book. And it was a successful, a moderately successful novel. But it was about somebody that I knew immediately I could write this person, you know, Brian Clough, immediately. And Brian Clough was, for me as a child growing up, being football crazy, it was like a Jose Mourinho now, you know, an arrogant, self-possessed, you know, person who enjoys provocation. And so for me to then write about Brian Clough, at a time where football has changed so much, it used to be such a local, specific, working class thing, and now it has become this ludicrous business, and with no sense of regional, local, you know. So something about how specific, again, it's this thing about being specific, which is also back to the point about staying in your local language, I suppose. I mean, nobody from America could have written The Damned United. And, you know, I was at university in Leeds, therefore everything to do with Leeds was, I spent 5 years there, so I felt very comfortable writing this. And it flew out of me. I wrote it very quickly. I love the project. Yeah.
Hey. I just had a quick question. So, I bet you worked in multiple writer rooms and had many different people working with you. I want to know if, in a scenario where you have this idea for a character or for a person, and another writer thinks that that's wrong, that it should be done in a different way, how much trust do you put in yourself, and how much trust do you have in other people? Who should you go with more? Do you understand?
I think you need to tell us a little bit more about what's going on in your life. This feels like you are speaking in a metaphor.
Yeah, I am.
And what's her name?
Oh, no. Not in that sense. I'm working on a movie right now, so that it happens a lot.
No. I it felt to me like you're burning with this issue right now. And I don't know that I can help you with that, except that collaboration is always painful.
Yeah.
But it's also necessary in a medium, which is collaborative. In this business of each job is a different party. In every job, the roles shift slightly. It may be that at the moment you're in a situation where you have to listen to other voices. In the next job or in the next situation, you may be in a position to be free of that. And you just have to find out, again, through endless painful experiences, which we all have, what the best system is for you. My writing partner that I started writing with loved exactly what you're talking about, loved it. He loved the idea, and it's very common, particularly in American television, that the showrunner will come in and say, I think this episode should be about, the lead character leaving his wife, and he runs off with X. And then someone else will go and write it. And then the group will discuss it. And then the showrunner might, with all this information in his head, rewrite it one more time. I couldn't work like that. But the whole vast industry of American television works along roughly this principle. And every person's journey, all our people with the outlines, every writer's journey is different. You will find where you belong, and you will find where the best place is for you, to express yourself, whether it's in a group, whether it's alone, whether you're the director because you can't bear somebody else taking it, or whether you love that. I mean, I love my relationships with my directors, but it can be painful too. But for the most part, I've had fantastic collaborations, and I repeat them,
Yeah, thanks.
Hi, I just had a question. I read recently that oftentimes, can you hear me? Sorry, we're good.
Can you hear?
Yeah, I read oftentimes that sometimes the most rewarding and best scripts or writing of any form that people end up doing is the one that scares them the most, the one that is either subversive, challenging, difficult in a number of ways, kind of daunting. And I was wondering if you had any experience with that, if you had ever been worried about writing a script, taking on an idea. You can have this mic if you need it.
I don't know that there's I don't know. I mean, it's always kind of terrifying. And it's sometimes it's terrifying. It's not terrifying until they pay you. And then when you get the biggest, you know, that horrible moment where you sell a commission, you get a pitch or whatever it is, and it's two feelings, you know. It's like, hooray, I've got the money, and oh no, no, I have to do it. And, you know, I get around that problem, by the way, by trying not to take any money. I just write it at home, and then if it works, take it out. Try and minimize the terror factor. I mean, if it's you sitting at home on your own, even if the subject matter is challenging, that's less frightening than taking money and failing. That's my biggest fear, is somebody pays me and then I deliver something that they can't use. I hate that feeling. I'm so anxious to please, or I'm so guilty, or I don't know what it is, pathetic really. But I don't have that fuck you thing. I just don't. I'm like, pathetic.
Hi. First, why are you here in Czech Republic?
I have no idea. I stepped on the wrong aeroplane. I was trying to go to New York.
And secondly, like with low attention spans of people, I feel humor in any film is like a prerequisite. And so what do you do to, say, how do you write a joke? Say, fit it in like a tragedy or drama, horror, like, how do you fit in jokes?
Well, I mean, if you sort of, you know, it depends how you look at a situation. For example, if you look at the situation of the Queen sitting there with a Prime Minister in conversation, that's inherently the dullest, stupidest, most awful situation. But it is also absurd. And most situations, you know, are, I think if you look for jokes, you know, I don't know, I don't think I've ever written a joke. But I do think things can be inherently funny or witty. And I would absolutely expect to, you know, I think they're showing The Last King of Scotland here tonight. Yeah. But I mean, there are jokes in that, and that's about a genocidal psychopath. And the film takes him seriously. So I think I agree with you. I think you absolutely have to do it.
Like, would you say it would come out more once it's on film, or would you say it's pretty evident in the writing?
No, it's pretty evident in the writing, yeah. I think, yeah. But I mean, you know, sometimes it depends. I mean, it depends if you... You know, if you're naturally disposed towards writing stuff like that, or if you know what your shortcomings are, then hire people who can compensate for it. So if you are not a funny writer, then hire a director or try to work with a director who will see, you know, you've seen from their work. I try and do the opposite. I try and work with directors who make it more serious. Because my tendency is to put jokes in, or, you know, to see the funny side.
Hi, Mr. Morgan. What's your opinion on the writer-director? Like, a lot of people seem to be doing that, like the Coen brothers. Like, do you think people can do both at the same time well, or should they specialize in, you know, on the elbow, you know, as you said?
No, I mean, look, the Coen brothers are the most gifted people alive, and, you know... I don't know them personally, so I don't know how they divide things up. But I think they co-write, and then one produces and one directs. But I think they're kind of like a little Medusa with two heads, aren't they? I mean, I think they're, you know, and I think it's obviously a beautiful partnership. I'm friends, quite good friends with Michael Haneke, and he's a sublime writer and director. And I don't think he could work with, I mean, you know, he and I have often talked about collaborating, but I tell him there's no point. Why would he? He doesn't need someone to help him with writing. But mostly, I do think people are better at one or the other. And I think too many directors write when they're not talented enough at writing, And if you are a writer-director, you are essentially an unleashed fascist. With, you know, and actually most of my great friendships with directors have come as a result of them busting me over my script and me busting them over their edit. And the writer and the director holding each other to account is a very healthy collaboration, you know, if they're up to it. But do I think writer-directors are... I absolutely think there are some genius writer-directors, and but mostly I think you're one or the other, and then you have to accept, you know, that it's definitely a combative relationship. I can't pretend. Every film I make, at some point, involves me wanting to kill the director. And yet, I've ended up really close friends with all of them. There's only... I don't think there's any director that I've worked with that I don't have a good relationship with now.
Yes. Last question.
I don't know if this is worthy of a last question, but I very much enjoy your character studies of powerful people. And I'm wondering if you have anything to say about choosing such people as characters and why they might be advantageous for putting into your stories.
I think it's instinctive. I think you just, you know, there are lots of stories that people have asked me to write where you sort of think, wow, you know, that's a great story, but I don't know that I can write it. Or I have tried writing it and I just haven't been able to. And then there are other things where, you know, I suddenly find, ooh, I really can write this. And there was a case in point recently, actually. There was a story in England. Jan, you'd probably already left London, but there was a guy in Bristol. There was a woman disappeared. It turned out she was murdered, but she disappeared, and she was this beautiful 27, 28-year-old girl, blonde hair, engaged to be married, degree educated. She was like this, the perfect daughter of England. And she disappeared very uncharacteristically. And when her body was found after 10 days agony with the whole country looking for her, this man with terrible hair was arrested, who was her landlord. And all the newspapers just attacked him because of the way he looked. He looked like this ridiculous creature. And he spoke in this totally contrived way. And of course, I, like everybody else, when we saw him, I just said, well, lock this guy up now. He's a repressed, furious homosexual who has so angry with her for her glorious future and her conventional life that he hacked her to pieces, you know? I was absolutely sure of it. And sure enough, it was her neighbor who also lived in the same building, who was a Dutch engineer who had murdered her. She was left alone by her fiancé. This is all important, but she was left alone by her fiancé. Walks past his window on Christmas Eve or something. Her fiancé had gone to his parents, and this man had invited her in. He'd waved like that, and she had waved back. And in court, when he then said she wanted to have sex with me, the lawyer said, "Show me how she summoned you." He said, "Like this," and they said, "That's not this. That's this." And he'd gone into the room, and obviously he'd gone to kiss her. She'd started to scream. He'd be quiet. And this terrible tragedy had happened, that he'd strangled this girl and then put her in the snow. And anyway, they arrested this man with the hair. And then that's all I knew. Then I heard that it was this guy from next door. 18 months later, we're doing... The newspapers in England are being investigated for phone tapping. Did you ever read about this? I don't know if it made it to the Czech Republic, but News International, all the big Murdoch newspapers were investigated because they were phone tapping. They were bugging people to get stories. And into this whole debate about freedom of speech and inappropriate behavior of newspapers, this man gave evidence, and he looked like a sort of a corporate executive in his mid-50s. He had a bald head and side, you know, just tiny bits here. and he spoke, you know, it was him. I was like, oh my God, this man just cut off his hair. And just by the act of cutting off his hair, he had now become this leading light in this press freedom campaign. I said, I've got to write this story. I've got to write the story. I've got to meet this man. I've got to write the story. And I rang up his lawyers and I said, look, I know he doesn't want to meet me. He doesn't want to ever be treated by in the pub press again by anybody after the newspapers destroyed this man's life. Destroyed it. Murderer, pervert, pervert, homosexual, pervert, killer. So I went to meet him. He arranged to meet me at a railway station. And we met at a railway station, sat on this bench together, and I talked to him for a couple of hours. I said, please let me write your story. Please let me write your story. And I knew I had to write this man's story. I put everything down. I stopped everything that I was doing. And I just went to a television station, got a very small commission money-wise. There was nothing in it. But I just had this burning need to tell this story. And I would never have guessed. And this story, it's like I'm more proud of this story than anything else because it completely changed this man's life. People now come up to him in the street, they hug him, the whole country is apologizing one by one to this poor man. the film just won every prize it could win, and it was just a beautiful story. No one made any money, but it was like this lightning bolt came to me. This is the one time you get to do something good as a writer. Instead of just trying to entertain, this man needed to have his life back. So in answer to your question, it just comes out of nowhere sometimes. This is the only time it's been like that it really was like, you have to do this, you know.
Unfortunately, we have to finish. But please, can you stay on your seats? We do a photo. We go here in front, and our photographer makes a photo, because I never believed that we can make such a wonderful, perfectly organized lesson. Thank you also, Pavel. And let's go here.